Hi, this is our team for CIT37. We're doing a presentation on client-side wireless networks. We've got Brant Godfrey and Katherine Robeck here. We also have in our team Sterling Miller and Jake Alverson. All right, let's see. No. Back. Okay. Here you see all of our lovely team names. This is casting, right? It's sharing my screen.
Yeah, you're good.
Okay. Client-side wireless attacks exploit vulnerabilities in web browsers, media players, email applications, or other client software. They can use header manipulation, session hijacking, cookies, malicious add-ons, and drive-by downloads. They are not prevented by firewalls or web proxies. And a single vulnerability on a single workstation can be exploited to gain access to an entire network. So once been successful, they're inside the network, they can then use that position to attack other workstations on the network as well. A device that becomes infected with a virus or malware has the ability to connect to corporate networks from a distance. So even if a user is not at work, if they have a laptop that has the credentials to connect to their work network, then a client-side wireless attack will put that work network at risk because the attacker will still be able to access the work network remotely. And this way the user or client is helping to feed the virus along. These are a few examples of recent client-side vulnerabilities. Microsoft JPEG processing, Internet Explorer animated cursors, and the Sun Java plugin, Live Connect arbitrary package access. The exploits can even make use of fingerprinting info to target an attack.
All right, I think it's my turn. So, yeah. So, and I did a little bit of the exploits that she just went through. And the reason I brought some of those up is, you know, the first one, for example, just the Microsoft JPEG processing. You know, that's something that probably everyone uses for the most part. If you're running a version of Microsoft, or even if you run a different operating system and you run, say, like Microsoft Office on there. You could still be vulnerable to that. So, kind of a scary thing just to think that it's something that everyone uses and it's very, very vulnerable. Moving on, though, so this example that is next, I guess it's extremely simple, so I didn't know if I should put it or not, but it really displays how easy it is to get, you know, a virus or some malware on your work computer that can then be put to your work network. And so they're just saying here, hey, this application that we want to run is called Java. It's coming from Microsoft. It's being published by Microsoft, and it's coming from Facebook.com. There are a lot of people, including probably myself at some point, and I don't know, I can think of probably my parents as well, who, if something like that came up, they would probably say, oh, it's coming from Facebook, and they would click on it. And as soon as they do that, that's where the problems start, and they would probably never even know that they had been the victim of an attack, and a person would be able to get in and start executing malicious code. For example, my dad, he is an engineer. And every once in a while, when I lived at home, I remember he would come home and he would actually do a lot of work from home, but he would access his network at work when he was at home. And he'd always come home and he had some papers, and it even had one of those little token codes that would change periodically, clipped onto the pages, so he would have to go in and change it to be able to access it. I guess the only problem with that is if someone had already gained access to our home computer, they would already have access to his work network even with those token codes. So, moving on to the final part, which is the identification and defense. there's some really good things that you can do to prevent these kind of attacks from happening. And I'll just read what we have listed here. Keeping your operating system and apps or programs updated is big. Staying up to date with patches. Don't access things as an administrator as much as you can. And then set your browser permissions as low as possible. So it's not just going to start downloading things without asking for consent. And then finally, antivirus software, which I think most people understand that it's good to have some sort of antivirus software on their computer. As I was researching for this project, I came across a paper that was written and it included this last sentence that I have on here. The only way to effectively avoid attacks is to adopt the same approach as used in the wired world. Look at the network traffic itself. That's really what we have to do, and that's where it becomes extremely difficult and time-consuming because there are programs and software that can do that for us, but at the end of the day, it's going to take actual people watching the network, watching the traffic, and being vigilant to make sure these things don't happen quite as often. So.
All right, well, that's our presentation. Hope it was informative. I will end this hangout now.
Thanks. All right.